The success of the Iranian revolution actually led to the start of what you are seeing today. And if you realize, after the loss of Afghanistan, USSR also crumbled. And there crumbled the communist ideology-driven terrorism also. That was the death knell of terrorist movement which were following the communist ideology. Aim of Palestine, which was to liberate the entire Palestine.
Yeah.
It was the entire Palestine land is ours, and Israelis have no right to live in this part of the world. Hamas is a religious terrorism group. Fatah has abandoned that religious tag to it. It's the secular group, essentially now political in nature. It's a political party. They first eliminated Yasin, then they eliminated Hulsi, then they eliminated other lower level leaders one by one. But then they realized that the Hamas continues to grow in strength. So Hamas leader independent. Change which has taken place, as you said, that Hamas has evolved over a period of time. Somewhere it has started recognizing that, you know, taking the full land is now, it's almost impossible. Linked to this is another group which nobody normally knows about, is and which is more dangerous than Hamas, and in the same area with a little larger reach and more ferocious than Hamas, which gets unreported in the media, is PIJ, Palestine Islamic Jihad. And here is what I have crystal gazed and said that the next wave which is likely to come would be waves of independent terrorists.
Terrorism, it has affected us one way or the other. To discuss this today, I have with me Lieutenant General Dushyant Singh, PVSM, AVSM. Lieutenant General Dushyant Singh was commissioned into the 9th Battalion of the Maratha Light Infantry in December 1981. During the course of his service, he has served in various different terrains at various different positions and also as a United Nations observer. He holds the distinction of having served twice in the National Security Guards, once as the Deputy Inspector General and the second time as the Inspector General. He has been a Chief of Staff in the Eastern Command, commanded a corps, and just before his retirement, he was the Commandant of the Army War College. During his service, he has attended the Regional Defense Counterterrorism Program with specialization in terrorist operations and financing. That's where we bring him in today to discuss the terror groups of Hamas and Fatah. Thank you, sir, for joining me today on this very important discussion.
Good morning, Adi. It's good to be back on your platform and good to talk to you again. A very good morning to our listeners as well. Go ahead.
So these two groups, especially the Hamas, has made a lot of news in the past some time. You know, before we dwell into these two groups, I'd like to ask you a very broad-based question. The idea of terrorism is not new. The styles, of course, have changed over the years. It's, become more brutal, more, dangerous. My question to you is that how did this brutality of warfare emerge in modern times, and how has it been adopted by these groups?
You're right. Terrorism is as old as the civilization goes. If we really want to classify terrorism, we can put them in two eras. One is the ancient period, which I would say from 0 AD to 1830 AD, that thereabouts. And then the era of modern terrorism started from 1830 onwards. Right. So I'll briefly talk about it. Oh, there is a social scientist, David Rappaport, who tried to historically give a timeline to terrorism. So he says that the terrorism from 1830 onward or in the modern era has been coming in waves. There is a particular ideology. It's not that all the ideologies are not there in each of these eras, but there is one predominant ideology which overpowers the other ideologies. And so therefore, they are based on an ideological basis. I'm talking of the waves of terrorism. 40-year waves is what he calls. But a number of them also try to say that, no, it's not like this. that there are simultaneously coexistence of other ideologies as well. But by and large, I tend to support David Rappaport. So I will say that in the ancient era, they were, you could call thugs of Kali in India. They were like terrorists, they would catch hold of rich travelers going from Bihar to West Bengal, cut them, kill them, and then take their blood to get the power of Kali. So, that was kind of a terrorism where civilians were being inflicted upon by a group of people. Then you had in the Middle East, there were a group of Muslims who used to have a cult-based action against civilians, etc. So, like this, you've had a series of kind of terrorist activities, right? But in a formal format, it started off from 1830s, And so, therefore, what he has done is to classify them into four waves. And each wave corresponds to a major event. So the first wave is he corresponded to World War One.
Okay.
So around World War One, there was, if you take your mind to that era, you'll find a spate of anarchic movements taking place. Russian Revolution, French Revolution. So there was this terror acts being committed based on anarchy as a primary ideology. Okay. And this lasted till the World War One got over. And then a League of Nations was formed, and thereafter there was some sense of nationhood done in the overall global scenario. And League of Nations tried to control violence. But then what happened was a next wave started, which was of nationalism. See, there were colonial powers like French, the British, the Dutch, who were occupying various parts of the world, divided among themselves. Now, the local people of these areas started getting this nationalistic feeling, and there was a kind of a concentrated rise against colonialism. So there were a number of groups who took on to terrorism as a means to get independence. So this era, which is corresponding to the Second World War, we can call it as the era of nationalism-driven terrorism. And it ended with the colonialist losing the battle against the terrorist. What I'm trying to say is that terrorism was being driven by nationalistic feeling. It was also, you can see it in India, we adopted actions against the British Empire, which were violent in nature also. Similarly, in other countries, especially in Africa and Middle East, this was very, very predominant. So this was the second wave, so-called the nationalistic wave. Then after World War II, then United Nations was formed, And another terrorist movement started, which was driven primarily by left ideology. So that is the time you'll find entire South America driven by communist ideology. You had Peru, Colombia, and a whole lot of the South American insurgency started, then even in Cuba. Che Guevara became a mercenary guerrilla warfare fighter. He traveled, in fact, up to Africa to instigate insurgencies and terrorist movements. He finally met his match in South America and he died, of course. But the point I'm saying is there were other terrorist movements driven by other ideologies. But the primary driving ideology was communist ideology. So I would say the Kurds, for example, in the Middle East, they were also a left-leaning group which were fighting the Turks and fighting the Iraqis in that period. Later on, they have, in the fourth wave, which is the current wave, as we call it, which is called the religious ideological driven terrorism. Right? So we are, I for one feel that we are already outliving the 40-year cycle of religious terrorism. We started around 1980, where the Iranian Revolution was actually the precursor to religious terrorism. The success of the Iranian Revolution actually led to the start of what you are seeing today. Nobody normally relates it to that. See, it's always success which leads to such kind of, which leads to further action. And 1979 revolution was an out and out success against the US forces and the Shah of Iran. And then started this host of religious terrorist group getting motivated and taking up arms against the big enemy, against the far enemy and the near enemy. Most of the religious terrorist groups which are there in the Middle East and in South Asia are basically driven by the ideology that the far enemy is their main culprit of people opposing them. The near enemy is secondary. The far enemy is the US, UK, the West, which is supporting the near enemy, which is the king of Saudi Arabia or king of UAE. So like this, you know, the Indians are strong because we have a backing of USSR and US, etc. So when Afghanistan movement started off, everybody ganged against the USSR. All the Mujahids started flowing from all across the Middle East and South Asia and Southeast Asia into Afghanistan, all heralded by the US then and the Pakistani ISI to start the second major success of religious terrorism succeeding in the world. First was the Iranian one, second was the US, the action against USSR by the Mujahids under Muhammad Azam, who later on became the founder of Al-Qaeda, who was, people say, that Osama bin Laden got him assassinated, or it was an accident, but there is a theory, conspiracy theory, which says that Osama bin Laden was behind him, behind this, that particular incident. So Osama bin Laden then took over Al-Qaeda, and thereafter you all know what Al-Qaeda became and what now ISIS is. So these were two major defining actions as far as history of terrorism is concerned of the modern era, which has led to today's situation, what you are seeing, Hamas, PIJ, Hezbollah, Fateh, all these movements have actually, LET, you take JEM, host of Indian Mujahideen, they're all getting actually coming from these two major successes. One against the first superpower, second against the second superpower. And if you realize, after the loss of Afghanistan, USSR also crumbled. And there crumbled the communist ideology-driven terrorism also. That was the death knell of terrorist movements which were following the communist ideology. And that's why you'll find now today that communist ideology-driven terrorist movement is only existing in India, which is in the Naxal area. Otherwise, world over, you will find that it has gone extinct. So this, in my view, is the precursor to today's religious terrorism. But we are seeing the fag end of this, as per that theory of 40-year cycle.
Something
very. Take 1990 as the start of. As the actual start of religious terrorism, when Mujahideens started fighting in Afghanistan, etc. So then we are now almost reaching the 40-year period.
Something very interesting you said, sir, and I think, I don't know, I'm going to take a little step and actually say this. This is what I understand is today's terror groups have actually studied these 3-4 waves in their own particular way, and they've mixed and matched their objectives and put it across in front of the world. Wherever, whatever suits them in whatever place. For example, in Kashmir, they all start off saying nationalistic and this and that and all that. It is religio-nationalistic sort of a thing. In India also, there is the other example of the communists, which are living probably 30 years behind everybody else. But yes, if you look at it in the Middle East, it is nationalistic more than the religious part of it, because you see the two, you know, joining hands and doing some, you know, tigdom around the place in that particular segment also.
You're right, Adi. When I said that there are no other ideologies, one ideology is primary, there is always going to be a secondary ideology.
Yeah.
Right. So ethno-nationalism. So it is ethnic drive along with a nationalistic drive.
Correct.
Which is driving a particular. So JNK, you can say Northeast, you can say it's almost like ethno-nationalism.
Ethno-nationalists.
JNK is ethno-religious. So they have an ethnic identity and they are also having a religious identity. And hence the Kashmiri Pandits were excluded from this ideology. Movement, if it was purely ethno, then they would have been part of this movement. But then it is ethno-religious, then the KPs go out of the scene. That's the slight difference between Northeast and the JNK thing. And as far as Naxals are concerned, it's purely a Maoist-driven ideological movement, which we need to solve the way the other Maoist-driven ideological movements have been resolved, which is basically to prove or to convince the people that communist ideology will not give you the desired results which you are seeking for. So that would become your conceptual basis to defeat those that movement. But whereas JNK is concerned, it is definitely ethno-religious nationalistic thing is there in that. Because, you know, there are people who are saying they want to get independent. There are people
that's
who
say
they join Pakistan. So there is a whole lot of other strands also moving in that. But the primary defining ideology is ethno-religious. That is what is we should be able to understand.
As they say in aircraft, right? 4++ generation, 4++ and 5++ and 4.5+. I think this is all that. They're just adding into this thing. So let's get on to the Middle East. You know, amongst the both the groups that we mentioned, also you also mentioned Hezbollah, which is a totally different paradigm altogether, originating from Lebanon and stuff like that. I'd like to, you know, the Hamas is a relatively newer group formed in the mid-80s. The Fatah is, you know, something which has been there with us for a long time. And it started up, you know, it gained a lot of prominence after the 67 war. I'd like you to, you know, tell us what were the other factors apart from the defeat in that region that led to the formation of the Fatah, which obviously is the PLO, the Yasser Arafat movement, and so on and so forth.
First of all, I think for us to understand the genesis of these two groups, we need to also understand what were the ground conditions in which these two groups have actually evolved. In my view, there is a fight of at 2-3 levels. As far as Israel is concerned, it's a fight for existence. They didn't have a land, right? So to say, defined. Palestinians thought they had a land, so to say. And they are trying to get back their land. Whereas the Jews don't have any other place to go. If they lose this, they have nowhere else to go. There is no other Jew country in the world. So for one, it is a fight of existence. So the reactions will always be very, very harsh and very, very intense. And when such a reaction happens, there is in social science, there is this theory of repression, counter-repression. And, you know, so if you repress a particular group of people, Instead of they subsiding, they actually rise back in the same stream again, moment the pressure is released. So you keep seeing these frequent wars which are taking place between Palestine and Israel. Palestine feels that the world has not done justice to it. Now, it doesn't have the backing of the powers that be. Unlike Israel, which overtly has the backing of the West, whether it is UK, France, or America. Now, if you combine their comprehensive national power, Israel itself is too big in terms of national military power. If you combine all these, Palestine stands no chance even with all the Arab countries
together.
So what does a group of people do in such a situation? It undertakes guerrilla warfare, subconventional warfare. It has been historically the case, and hence the birth of all Palestinian terrorist groups. The first in this line was Fateh. As you are aware, after the first war, 750,000 Palestinians fled Palestine to all around the Arab countries, Egypt, Jordan, Lebanon. Now, so therefore, there was a concurrent group of Palestinians who were actually living in these countries. So they went to school in that country. So they started a life in that country. So what happened was, in around 1950s, 57, 56, a group of students got together with the acronym GUPS and formed Fatah under the leadership of Yasser Arafat, and there were 2-3 more founder leaders of Fatah. And then they started undertaking terrorist activities. So Yasser Arafat started off as a out and out pure terrorist leader. It was only in the 1964 when PLO got formed, Palestinian Liberation Organization, which had a group of other militant groups also part of the PLO, who formed a front to fight the Israeli forces for liberation of Palestine land. Okay, and in 64 then Arafat was elected as the president, and he remained the president of PLO and Fateh both till he died. That is in 2004, when some people say that he was poisoned. I mean, that's a conspiracy theory on that. Nothing has been proved, but there is a very strong belief that he was poisoned to death, as far as Arafat was concerned. Now, for 10 years in the 60s and 70s, Fatah actually conducted terrorist activities. You would be aware of the Munich Olympic Games killing of the athletes, and then the Israelis went about killing each and every one of them involved by tracing them one by one in various parts of the world. So that was the kind of terror activities they were actually conducting. Subsequently, because of the various accords which have happened over a period of time, I will not go into them. Oslo was the final defining accord, which led to the agreement by both the sides that yes, there is a need to recognize Palestine also, and Palestinians agreed that there is a need to recognize Israelis as well. Both have a right to live. Although, mind you, UN had given this decision way back in 1948 that the land will be divided into two parts, 55% going to the Israel, state of Israel, with 34% population, and 44% going to the Palestinians with much larger population. But that was what it was, and Jerusalem was put under the UN control. But it was only later on that both of them recognized that yes, there is a need for both of them to live as two nations. So that's how the theory of two nations was born. And then Arafat became formal leader of Palestinian Authority and remained as its president till 2004 when he died. So there was so Hamas was still not there in the picture till then. Hamas started coming in the picture once Gaza Strip started having issues with Israel, and the first Intifada started, 1987, in which there were 400 suicide attacks actually conducted by Hamas. So the birth of Hamas is related to the first Intifada, where they felt that somehow the PLO was compromising the aim of Palestine, which was to liberate the entire Palestine.
Yeah.
It was the entire Palestine land is ours, and Israelis have no right to live in this part of the world. We own this land and it is ours. And so was Jerusalem. Jerusalem has actually been at the center of dispute for everyone, Arabs, Christians, as well as Jews. But this basic difference was that PLO was ready to live with this two-nation kind of a approach. But Hamas, a group of theocratic leaders, I would put it, under Yasin, who was the founder leader, he was a wheelchair-bound professor, a teacher, who started this particular movement. And then he was assisted by Runsi. And later on, now, of course, you have Hanaya Islamia as the leader living in Qatar. And within Gaza Strip, it is Sinwar, who is the military leader of Hamas. Fatah and Hamas started fighting with each other in Gaza Strip after the 2006 elections for Palestinian Authority.
Hmm.
After the death of Yasser Arafat. Okay. Once Yasser Arafat died, then there was a need to conduct an election for the Palestinian Authority governance because the president had died. Now, the West felt that PLO commands enough popularity in the region to win the elections. When the elections took place, the results were surprising. Hmm. Hamas won majority 74 seats in a parliament of 126, and therefore, technically, the president should have been elected from Hamas, and the government of Palestine, which had a self-rule, so-called self-rule with limited powers, both for West Bank and Gaza Strip, should have been Hamas. Now, that was not acceptable to the West, to Israel, and also to the PLA, which had elected Mahmoud Abbas as the leader of the government. Which was supposed to take over. A compromise formula was derived that, you know, okay, president will be from Fatah and the Prime Minister Hanaya Islamia will be from the, Ismail will be from the Prime Minister from Hamas. This not being accepted, Fatah and Hamas had a civil war in Gaza. Without even thinking, you would know who would have won the war. Gaza won the civil war between Fatah and Hamas, and Hamas took total control of
Gaza.
This is as far as how now Palestine is divided into two distinct parts. One controlled by Fatah, of course, with the backing of Israelis also in that, because Israelis are more or less now reconciled to the fact that Fatah is the group to back if they want to have peace in the region. And Hamas has been given the control of Gaza. This is as far as history is concerned. And thereafter, we have seen frequent battles between the two sides, essentially restricted to Gaza and Israel. Mm. But let me also tell you about Hamas proper, what it is. To understand it in the correct perspective, why it is so dangerous. First of all, Hamas is a religious terrorism group.
Mm.
Fatah has abandoned that religious tag to it. It's a secular group, essentially now political in nature. It's a political party. Whereas Hamas has a political wing called Dawa and a military wing, which is called Al-Qassam. Now, Al-Qassam is the military wing which has got a number of brigades under it. It has its own rocket producing factories inside the Gaza Strip. It has a secure chain for supply of rockets coming from Iran via the Egyptian route. They have made tunnels along in the Sinai Peninsula from which cash as well as the rockets come. Now, the same chain has actually helped them in establishing these factories inside the Gaza. So what has happened is their dependence on instability of the chain getting intercepted by the Israelis has almost been got over. The funding is coming from a number of countries. Qatar, you have Iran, then you have even, that is why I say in terrorism is a very complex game. Even Israel gives money to Gaza for the welfare of the people there. Okay, as part of its administrative responsibilities to pay to the employees, etc. But where does this money go? This money doesn't go for welfare. This money goes back into the coffers of the Hamas leadership and the Hamas militant wing. Similarly, the donations which come from other countries also get into this. They are sent there as even the West gives, funds for relief work in Gaza. But how much of relief is actually getting transferred to the locals? So what is happening? The money is getting diverted for weapons, for payment to the militant wing, brigades which are there, and also for the leaders who are living outside in 5-star facilities. And I'm talking of Khalid Mashal and Hanaya, who are living in Qatar in the best of the facilities available. It is Sinwar, Yahya Sinwar, who is actually fighting the battle on ground in Gaza Strip. He's been very, very careful. He has not made any inflammatory statements. He has left making of statements to the political leaders who are there in Qatar, which is Hanaya basically. Khalid Mashal is looking after their foreign bureau. So point I'm getting at is that the Israelis tried to eliminate their leadership. That was a strategy made. They first eliminated Yassin, then they eliminated Runsi, then they eliminated other lower level leaders one by one. But then they realized that the Hamas continues to grow in strength. So Hamas is leader independent. That is the second dangerous trend of Hamas. So therefore, after a while, the Israelis have given up on this leadership targeting. Focused, targeted leadership killings have been done away with, because they realized Hamas is leader independent, which means that as a group, it is the most dangerous group in that area. Normally, if you kill Arafat, once he was killed, Fateh has become almost like a dead wood. It was a charismatic leader who was leading them.
Yeah.
Here, it is nothing like that. That second dangerous trend of Hamas is that it specializes in suicide bombings. Maximum number of suicide bombings have been done by Hamas in the world today. How it creates volunteers after volunteers to commit suicide acts in Israel, and therefore it is dangerous to it is very, very difficult to intercept them. These suicide bombers are, once they are launched, they don't require any artificial intelligence, they don't require any cruise guidance, they are guided on their own and they will hit the target once whatever has been told to. The third dangerous trend of Hamas is that it has got its own weapon producing capability.
Yeah.
And it has found a way out of the Israeli so-called high-tech system of Iron Dome, etc. Now, Iron Dome has the capability to neutralize short-range rockets which the Hamas fires. They are known as Qassam series of rockets. They were initially coming from Iran, and subsequently they have started making it themselves. But now their ranges have gone up to almost 160 kilometers. So now they can get actually Tel Aviv also into their beaten zone or in the danger zone of these rockets. So Iron Dome spend almost 7 to 8 times more expenditure is done to beat $150,000 rocket. So they are actually draining the Israelis by deploying a very cheap technology and achieving their aim. And that is also one of the reasons, you know, international pressure was one issue, but the Israelis were also under pressure because they would fire all these rockets in a bunch.
Yeah.
even if you neutralize 90% of them, 10% would fall on your in your area. And since they are not guided, they will fall anywhere. And if they fall anywhere, they have a tendency to actually hit the civilians. You are aware, one of our nurses also got killed in this kind of a rocket attack only, which actually hurts somewhere for a nation which is in a limited number in strength as far as population is concerned. It is fighting for its existence. So therefore, I think there was a tit for tat in this last duel which happened between the two, that Israel also got hurt considerably. Yeah. And if you see the figures even of the last few rounds of exchanges which have taken place between Hamas and Israel, Hamas has been able to inflict, of course, major sufferer has been the people of Gaza Strip, but even Hamas has inflicted considerable casualties on the Israelis. So in these three, and the last thing which makes Hamas dangerous is their funding. Qatar till now has given about $1.8 billion to them, and it continues to give to pay their employees. Iran continues to give them money, almost $6 million a year. 27 million they get almost from tax collections, etc. And I'm not even talking about donations. I'm not even talking about the grants which are given by various agencies to the people of Gaza, which actually don't reach the people of Gaza, but it reaches Hamas. So this is the difference between Hamas and Fatah. Fatah is a deadwood. Hamas is the force today to reckon with. And we have to actually defeat Hamas to get peace and stability in the region.
I think that gives us a very, very good understanding of both the groups. And one thing that you've actually mentioned is Hamas has been able to evolve along as time goes by into a very, very thought out process. If you're actually trying to say that they can function without a leader, that's one of the most dangerous things. So one thing is that these style of Islamic movements have, you know, if we see the recent spat between both of them, the world kind of moved up and down. You had videos floating around from UK, from US, from Canada, from a little bit of, reverberation was also felt in Kashmir. Are these guys actually putting across a message to the rest of the world's religious based or Islamic based movements and trying to teach them the ways of doing things?
I would say yes and no. Yes, why I am saying so is because these movements are interconnected by digital world.
Hmm.
So what is happening in Israel and Palestine will automatically reach the groups which are fighting in JNK or fighting in Afghanistan or fighting in Boko or fighting in Nigeria, right? As part of Boko Haram. So there is an immediate connectivity because of the technology which is now today existing. So the impact, definitely yes. Whether Hamas is trying to teach the others, I would say that would be taking it a little too far. They are fighting their battle for their own survival and for their own aims, which is to basically liberate Palestine, the land of Palestine, which they had pre-1947.
Yeah.
And the change which has taken place, as you said, that Hamas has evolved over a period of time, somewhere it has started recognizing that, you know, taking the full land is now, it's almost impossible.
Mm.
So possibly there is a room now being made by Israeli, by the Hamas leadership to look at a solution, look at a layback solution, which is not an all-out, either full or nothing. That position is, I think, being somewhere re-looked at by Hamas leadership, and that is the reason why you had the recent ceasefire, which was brokered by Egypt, taking place. They may also be doing this ceasefire to regain their lost strength. You know, after all, they have fired so many of rockets, etc. They have to regain and recoup their arsenal to again stand back and fight the Israelis. So both the reasons are there for the ceasefire. So therefore, I feel that the teaching is more natural because of the connectivity which is there, and therefore the other groups will take a cue from it and try to make themselves less leader dependent, which is the most dangerous trend now which is emerging. If you see the past history of terrorism, there was this method of eliminating the leader. There was a chance for you to finish that group thereafter. But Hamas is proving that wrong. If any group which has suffered maximum leadership kills, it is Hamas. And yet they have survived and they are becoming more and more stronger in their role. Linked to this is another group which nobody normally knows about, and which is more dangerous than Hamas, and in the same area, with a little larger reach and more ferocious than Hamas, which gets unreported in the media, is PIJ, Palestine Islamic Jihad. It is more closer to Iran. It has a steady supply of funds from Iran. It has presence even in West Bank, Hebron. And it has, of course, a major presence in Gaza. It is in collation with Hamas. It fires rockets more liberally and more willingly, sometimes even disobeying to Iranians. Its brigades are called Al-Qud brigades. That is Al-Qasim brigade, and this is Al-Qud brigade. So the Al-Qud brigades are supposedly more dangerous, less disciplined, and therefore capable of causing more danger and more damage to the opposition. They are in existence in 1981, whereas Hamas came into existence in 1987. Why Hamas became popular was Hamas backs up their military activities with considerable amount of welfare activities.
Okay.
So the Dawa, which they have, the Dawa wing, which is the political wing, is actually very popular amongst the people. See, they may not be putting in the entire money which they get, but definitely they do put in the money in the schools, hospitals, etc.
You know, one thing which comes out here is that these groups are evolving and they're not stagnant. I mean, the PLO, who kind of became stagnant today, has literally gone out of the woods and come out to be a political party sort of a thing, as a political movement as per se. But one thing which was very interesting during this recent ceasefire, sir, we saw these two groups communicate within each other and they were in sync for a certain amount of time. Although direct support may not be there of any kind or anything, but they were in sync, because the statements coming out from both the sides were similar on quite a lot of senses. What would you say, that is there any cooperation between these two groups? Although they have fought a civil war, they have fought a long time for the control of both the areas and stuff like that, but do you think it is possible that there is a connection building up between these two groups now again?
I think that's a very good inference which you're trying to get into the discussion. But if you realize, a few minutes back I had said that Hamas is now gradually shifting its position from all or none to somewhere in the middle now. Okay. Yeah. So maybe Hamas is looking now at the UN solution, which was 55-48. What is PLO's, what is the current state of Palestine? It is 12%.
Yeah.
So from a 40 plus percentage of land which they had, they have got reduced to 12%. 12% of the rest of the land is all controlled by Israel.
Yeah.
So even if Hamas is able to get somewhere close to the UN formula, or for that matter, some control in Jerusalem, it would be a victory for Hamas and peace for the region. So maybe I think the leaders, political leaders, always think a little far ahead. So the statements which are coming, which came during that period, and in any case, since the Fatah has been disbanded, I mean their fighters have been disbanded and got into a normal security forces domain, so they're acting as the security forces of the Palestinian Authority. So therefore, they don't have this capability now what Hamas has to actually get back at Israel. So there is a give and take, I think. There's a mutual benefit for both the sides. That look, politically, we are dealing with them. And militarily, if you are capable of it, dealing with them, it is putting pressure on the... after all, what was the common voice which Israelis were saying? Why can't they become like the Fateh or like the PLA? So somewhere there is this, I think, this urgent need for the people to look at a solution. The problem which I face is that in the current scenario, you cannot have a two-nation solution. With the current disposition, the way the land is now divided, if you show the map, West Bank in one corner, Hamas in Gaza in second corner, in between all Israel floating around. It's like East Pakistan and West Pakistan of India. It's an unnatural combination of, and it is bound to fail. So it has to have a contiguous, either a solution has to be a contiguous region, some uprootings will have to take place, some disenchantments will have to take place, some walls will have to be broken. West Bank is now, as you are aware, the Israelis are putting a wall around the West Bank so that you know the movement is controlled, etc. So there is good. It's a very complex situation. I keep saying now it will become three nations. West Bank with some name and Gaza with second name and Israel in the third category. There is an outer solution suggested by somebody. I will cover it subsequently when you go ahead to the next question.
As a matter of fact, that is my next question, sir. We officially support in India a two-nation theory for this entire thing. I mean, there was a big clamor within the country with regards to our support to Israel, with regards to our overt support to Israel, if I may put it that way. Covertly, everybody knows we are with Israel and there is no two questions about it. But overtly, we do support the two-nation theory. We do support peace in the region and this and that. Obviously, that is something that we need to do. Now, you know, we were talking some time back and you had mentioned this to me that it should not become a three-nation theory as what has happened in India. And one thing, history teaches us one thing, especially about the Southeast Asian regions, is wherever there has been a man-made line that has been drawn, there has been issues. So for someone to probably a UN solution or something like that, they are hoping for. Personally, this is my opinion, sir. I mean, you can correct me if I'm wrong. I don't think it will work, is because any line drawn by a third party will not be acceptable to either one of them. So this situation is bound to explode. My question to you is, sir, you know, I'd like you to kind of take us through what the proposal of the two-nation theory is. And what are the, I mean, you mentioned that one, it's the geography, which is obviously off in this particular thing. What do you think is then the solution to this problem?
Put is that both Israel and Palestine have the right to live in that part of the world. Both should be given commensurate land to live on, and both should recognize each other. I think a lot of ground was covered on this particular aspect. But where the whole situation went out of gear was that Hamas refused to accept the two-nation theory. That was one issue. And secondly, the geography of that area, of this two-nation, the way it is today, is coming, is to my view, a big obstacle to the two-nation theory. How do you connect Hamas and West Bank with in between Israel thrown in is something which to my mind is an unnatural configuration of a nation. So somewhere I think it has to be a contiguous land which has to be given. There was an out-of-box solution suggested by one of the security experts which I was going through, and I kind of liked the idea. It may be a very bizarre idea, but it may be the possible way to go ahead. And this, what he said was that why don't the three adjoining areas, that is West Bank, be taken over by Jordan, Gaza be taken over by Egypt. Let the two nations negotiate with Israel for peace and stability in the region. And there be thereafter some rights over Jerusalem, which is one of the major reasons for the conflict, to be accessed by everyone in equal measure, or it should be divided as Al-Aqsa Mosque and the Temple Mount. These two areas could be divided in a manner that both have access to this, or that is the Arabs and the Jews, have access to this holy site of theirs. Al-Aqsa Mosque is the third most prestigious holy site as far as the Muslims are concerned. So therefore, it's not easy to forego that claim for the Arabs also. So this will satisfy everyone to begin with. So what his logic was that today the negotiations are taking place between Israel and Palestine. Palestine has no single authority to negotiate with Israel. Palestinian leaders do not have the muscle or the clout or the wherewithal to negotiate with Israel. Whereas if Egypt was negotiating with Israel, or if Jordan was negotiating with Israel, claiming that yes, Hamas is part of, sorry, Gaza is part of Egypt and West Bank is part of Jordan, and then come up with a solution. That is, first you just merge them with the two big nations. And then once they are part of that, those nations can give them a full-fledged autonomy. To self-rule, to do whatever they want to do, live in peace and harmony. And then subsequently work out a solution later on by sitting together and then carving out a land for the Palestinians afresh. This could be extended to the extent that even the Golan Heights could be included in this, and even the Lebanese areas which are in the north bordering Israel, those could also be included, and a peripheral nation created of single geographical mass to give it to the Palestine. And the negotiations then are on equal terms with equally powerful nations. I won't say they are equally powerful, but yes, they are nations actually. If Egypt can broker a ceasefire, I'm sure they can negotiate also. They negotiated Sinai Peninsula. Sinai Peninsula is now very, very peaceful. So this is one solution which is possible as far as this. So I say debunk the two nation theory. Merge these two areas with the two big powers, Jordan and Egypt. And thereafter, enter into discussions with, enter into agreement with Israel on the fate of these two areas. Once peace and stability is created in these two areas, then recommence the negotiation for a Palestinian land.
State.
A Palestinian state.
And that's actually where my next question comes to, because with the kind of radicalization which we see in that region, a lot of it spreads across the world. We saw a big boost in all this stuff, especially when the IS came into power in that area. Iran, of course, being a rogue power, has been fueling this thing. And we also see the two opposite sects in the Muslim faith, which is the Shia and the Sunni, literally having a deal saying, you know, yeah, let's fight them first. Aapas mein hum baad mein lad lenge. And we can see that happening as well. And it's an amazing thing that how these things are evolving, sir. Now, with this kind of a very, very heavy scenario where they are being pushed into actually, you know, making some sort of a time being peace with somebody they've been at war for about 1400 years with each other, amongst each other, to get a third enemy. The reason why I'm saying this is because to put across a solution and to actually get the entire area de-radicalized, it's taken it 40 years for it to be radicalized, it's going to take 40 years to come down as well. So in the, at least in the next half a century, we don't see this going down. That's point one. Point two is, if you're mentioning that 40-year cycle of these waves of terror that you had explained to us, sir, don't you think this will actually get into a sixth or the seventh or a very hybrid wave that we've really not been able to put our finger onto at the moment?
Yeah. So the answer to the first question is when and how is it going to get tided? My sense is that terrorism never goes off.
Mm.
It will take a different form.
Morph. Mm.
This kind of articulation will start dying down.
Mm.
And the reason for that, I assume, is fatigue. There is a limit up to which a population or a people can suffer. So, given the way people in Palestine are being harassed, and that is why I said that, you know, go ahead with a solution which is being part of a bigger nation for the time being, with the proviso that let's renegotiate our lands in a peaceful manner. Till then, they have the land to live properly, peacefully, with full modern amenities of life available to them, and not live in a pitiable condition as the way they are living in Hamas and West Bank, right, with tunnels and things like that. Okay.
Mm.
The fatigue is one important issue. That is why that 40-year cycle which I was talking about.
Yeah.
The second reason for such waves to go down are defeats.
Okay.
Successes are the reasons to rise, and defeats are the reason to
fail.
To fail. Now, if you see, America has failed. Okay. So there has been a resurgence of, there will be a resurgence of Islamic movements again.
Yeah.
Based on the fact that Taliban was able to, you know, send back US from Afghanistan without losing ground. We have to reverse the cycle. And how can we reverse these cycles? Is by proving that they are not going to succeed. I think Palestine is one area where this message is going out. Mm-hmm. Syria was second area where ISIS got defeated.
Yeah.
We have to start the counter narrative that this kind of a warfare is going to lead you nowhere. Iraq has been fully liberated from ISIS. They still have their roads. They still conduct their terrorist activities here and there. But the intensities have gone down. Similarly, although the Afghanistan chapter US has lost, but post withdrawal of Afghanistan, if Taliban evolves, or if there is a government which is of reconciliation of everybody, it would also mean that such movements are now losing steam.
Yeah.
because of people fatigue. After all, who are dying? People who are dying are common people. They are dying, their children are dying, the schools are getting destroyed. There is a limit up to which you can, the crops are getting damaged in Afghanistan. So I feel when the successes start coming because of the fatigue which is taking place, whether due to direct action of the powers that be, or by simply the length and duration of the conflict which is going on. If Kashmir succeeds, this wave will start going down. But The second question which you said would mean that the elements who are counter-state will never rest in peace.
Yep.
They will start looking at alternate models, alternate ways to conduct their terrorism. And here is what I have crystal gazed and said, that the next wave which is likely to come would be waves of independent terrorists.
Okay.
George Soros, digital terrorists, social media platform owners. Today, owner of a social media platform may be a very sane and a balanced man. Can he be taken over by somebody who is not so?
Possibly, yes.
After all, it is just displacing a person.
Yeah.
And then what he can commit in a country, it is for everyone to see. With even minor tweakings, minor artificial intelligence and big data computing, people are able to generate demographic intelligence, hit the minds of the people of that particular country and sway the decision of elections, create internal rivalries. So I think the fifth wave is going to be a technology driven, I am calling it a digital guerrilla warfare. This is the word which I have used for it, is going to be the next wave. People will find ways and means to achieve their aims. If it was the era of suicide terrorism, religious terrorism, this is going to be the era of digital guerrilla.
I must compliment you. So the way you have put this answer across is a brilliant analysis of this whole thing, because at the end of it, that is a very common question that will come to somebody's mind. What next? We have car bomb kar chuke hain, hijacking kar chuke hain, apne aap ko uda chuke hain, ab aur kya karenge isse zyada? And you know, the popularity of a suicide bomber today is not what it was in the 80s and 90s. You know, previously it was those guys were up in the sky, they were treated as kings and stuff like that. Today it's not the case. It is coming down. The popularity is more of the silent killer. Absolutely. And I agree with you, sir. I think that is a very, 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 very nice analysis, and thank you so much for joining that particular dot. Sir, this has been a brilliant discussion. You know, just to understand the world of Hamas, how it has evolved over the years, I don't think I would be mistaken to say that they actually learnt what mistakes that the PLO made, and they went on to become something that the PLO wasn't. And that probably is one of the reasons why they are you know, at loggerheads with each other as well. Sir, thank you so much. You've done very extensive research in terms of the beginning of these organizations, their perpetuations, their points of contradiction and points of battle, and to the present day. And as well as, I must also say that the general has also given us a view into the future as to what we see happening in the next few years in terms of the next wave of terrorism. Sir did mention about social media platforms. I don't think I need to reiterate what is happening with us in India. It's if I may just throw a figure, it's 1.75% Indians that use Twitter, but the amount of news that 1.75% is generating with regards to a small battle that is taking on in some court is quite hard. So we can actually see an example of what General Dushyant actually mentioned. Thank you so much once again, sir. It's been a pleasure. Thank as you. Always. And we'll catch up with everybody else on the next series of terror groups. I think we will try and focus towards a little more towards the Indian subcontinent, so that we can relate a little bit towards the home front as well. But I think all of these guys are going to take some amount of motivation from the from a successful terror organization, if I may put it that way.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you.
Jai Hind, sir.